second grade can. Just keep going, and you can. Should I grab a different microphone? I'm good. No, I'm not. Okay, there we go. We're still trying to figure stuff out here, if you haven't figured that out yet. Great to be here today. I was gone last week, but it is great to be back. I'm going to keep using the handheld microphone, and we'll go from there. We are in a study right now of Romans chapter 8. And if you have a Bible, turn to Romans chapter 8. We're going to be looking today at verses 18 through 27. My wife and I and our family connected up with Lori's family last weekend. We were on the coast. So last Sunday, it was, I think the high was about 68 up on the north coast. So it was really nice. And I apologize I didn't bring that cool weather back with us here. But good to be back. In fact, I don't know if you've had this experience yet. If you've been gone at all in the last couple weeks and then come back, what a blessing to come back and worship with God's people. You know, when you miss a Sunday and then come back, it just is a blessing to be here. So good to be together here today. We're going to be looking at, or can I go without? Hey, all right, way to go, Dana. We're looking at Romans chapter 8. Verse 18 through 27, and let me just begin by reading the first verse. We're going to read it all in just a second, but let me start with verse 18. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. This is written by the Apostle Paul. Paul is writing to the Romans. He's trying to encourage the Romans. Paul maybe uniquely has experienced suffering amongst the early church. And I want us to think about suffering that we might have experienced. And I thought just kind of a fun vacation story I would start with that resulted in a little bit of suffering. My wife and I were just newly married, maybe a year, maybe 2 years. We were living in Hayward. She was going to grad school in Berkeley. I was working at a church in Dublin. So we lived in Hayward. I would drive over the hill to Dublin. She would drive up to Berkeley. And I was a youth director at a church. It was time for summer vacation. My parents were living in Denver. So we drove out to Denver in her little Subaru that she used to drive around, a little red Subaru, had close to 200,000 miles on it. And besides having a blown out tire in the middle of the salt flats on that trip, we, on our way back, were coming to Wendover, Nevada, which is right on the border of Nevada and Utah. Anybody been to Wendover? Few of us? Yes. We were there. We were camping because we can afford to stay in a hotel. And we threw up a tent. It was so windy. It was just blowing. They call it Wendover for a reason. I mean, it was just blowing our tent over. You just say, no, we've got to stay in a hotel, no matter how much, you know, we have a hard time affording it. So we rolled up our tent, threw it back in the trunk, went into this cheapo hotel there, and eventually got home. But what we noticed that night when we were at the hotel, I think it was even dinner time, we were eating at a little Pizza Hut, and I looked and my wedding ring was gone. I thought, oh no, like what happened? And we thought it must have happened when we were setting up the tent. And back then, so we were just newly married. My wedding ring was really loose. It's not as loose as it used to be, amazingly enough, you know, but it had come off. And so we were at Pizza Hut. They had these little baskets with kind of mesh baskets. We grabbed a couple of those. We sifted through the sand. We were like gold miners. We were looking for a gold wedding ring. We were sifting through the sand of the tent site with these little baskets, and we could not find my wedding ring. And it was getting dark, and finally we said, we've just got to give up. And we were so discouraged. Stayed at the hotel, got back home. Sunday hit. So when you're in ministry and you're on vacation, you know, you come back right before a Sunday, which is kind of what we did this week. You come back right before a Sunday, you have Sunday, and then like Sunday, you're finally unpacking. Sunday afternoon, late into the evening, I'm unpacking the back of the Subaru. Thankfully, decided that I would unroll the tarp that our tent was on and clean it off. As I unrolled the tarp, inside the rolled up tarp was my wedding ring. Somehow, as I'd rolled it up, it had slipped off, gotten in that tarp. I tell you what though, those 2 days of not having my wedding ring, I was just so discouraged. I mean, as any of us would be if you lose something, but maybe especially a newly married couple, you lose your ring. For many of us, we have experienced loss and hardship. In fact, as we think about it, and this is something I put in your message notes, loss, whatever the loss might be, can lead to suffering that can lead to discouragement and despair. I was discouraged because I lost my wedding ring. Some of the loss that we've experienced here is, of course, much greater than just something physical like a wedding ring. What Paul is writing to here, to the early church, to the Romans, who, as he's writing, he's come to this wonderful place in this epistle to the Romans, saying there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. There's no condemnation. You belong. You're a part of my family. Pastor Ted talked about that last week. He comes to this place in Romans chapter 8, and he's addressing this question that the people have. Yes, I understand I'm not condemned. Yes, I understand I belong to God's family. But why do I feel like I'm being punished? Why is life so hard? And that's what he's talking about here. And certainly what the early church faced was different than us. The Apostle Paul, maybe more than any of us, experienced hardship. Let me just read a few things that he went through from 2 Corinthians chapter 11. This list, this amazing list Paul talks about here. He goes on and on. He says, I've worked harder. I've been in prison more frequently. I've been flogged severely. 5 times I received from the Jews 40 lashes. 3 times I've been beaten with rods. Once I was pelted with stones. This is Paul's own experience. 3 times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I've been constantly on the move. I've been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my fellow Jews, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, in danger from false believers. I've labored, I've toiled. I've often gone without sleep. I've been hungry and thirsty. I've gone without food. I've been cold. I've been naked. Besides everything else, I face daily pressure of my concern for all the churches. Who is weak and I do not feel weak? Who's led into sin and I do not burn inwardly? But if I boast in my weakness. And he goes on. Paul has experienced hardship and discouragement. The early church had hardships that we cannot relate to. Hardships just finding food. Remember the controversy about food offered to idols. What food should they eat? What can they eat? Can they get food? How do they relate socially in the society? Because they're no longer a part of the synagogue, the temple community. Their own personal security and safety. Their lives were in danger. Many lost property, especially if they lived in Jerusalem. Some lost their lives. Loss leads to suffering that can lead to discouragement and despair. Let me read these verses for us and look at what Paul says to the people here in Romans chapter 8. I'm going to pick up in verse 19. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, and hope that creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning, as in the pains of childbirth, right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who are the first fruits of the Spirit, grown inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not have yet, we wait for it patiently. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him and have been called according to his purpose. I'm going to stop there. I'm just giving you a teaser there with verse 28, because we're going to actually come to that next week. I'm holding off. That's kind of a culmination of some of what he's talking about here. So what is Paul saying about overcoming discouragement? Let me just make a few observations, and then I'm going to give you 3 points about how we overcome discouragement and loss and despair. You know, notice right away in verse 19, he says, creation was subjected to frustration. As we're reading through that, circle that word frustration or underline it. Frustration, what's that from? It's from sin. God didn't create evil, but he created humanity. Humanity chose to sin. And God knew it would create a problem, but God had a bigger picture. Verse 21, creation itself will be liberated. It'll be brought into freedom and glory. Verse 22, all of creation has been groaning, as in the pains of childbirth. So creation is groaning. Interesting, as New Testament scholars write about this passage, we often just jump right over the idea that creation itself is affected by the fall. We go out, we see the beauty of creation, but to recognize that all of the world is affected by sin. It's not just our lives that are messed up. There's certainly a beauty in creation, but here it's saying all of creation is groaning. It's waiting. And it was interesting today, even in our worship, as we were singing about exalting the Lord, and we exalt you. We exalt God with all of creation. All of creation is anticipating that glory that is to come. Like childbirth, it says. You know, nothing is more painful, nothing lasts longer than it should. And for all the women out here, you know more than we, of course. Of course, I had a kidney stone. Somebody said, Mark, that's maybe the closest thing. Passing that kidney stone is a wonderful experience. But just as with childbirth, we anticipate something that is to happen. Paul here talks about our adoption to sonship, Paul's greatest metaphor. Out of this frustration, now the Spirit helps us in our weakness, helps us to pray. These are some of the themes that Paul brings up in this passage. So how do we overcome discouragement? What do we understand about these ideas that relate to our lives today? How does this matter to us? Well, like I said, our problems today are different than what Paul was experiencing. Probably none of us have experienced what Paul did, being shipwrecked, being beaten, being lost at sea, all of those things. But the discouragements are the same. Our problems are different. You've heard that phrase, you know, first world problems. Our problems are different than other people's. You know, you drop your computer. Oh no, I dropped my computer, you know, and it landed on another computer. Or, you know, I dropped my phone and the screen cracked. You know, these are our problems. But there are discouragements. There are frustrations. How does this matter to us today? as we look at our own lives, all of us have experienced loss to some degree. If I could look out right now and just see over each of you a little idea bubble to see what's in your head as we talk about loss and hardship and discouragement, our stories would be amazing. I think we would have an empathy and a grace towards one another if we really could see what we have experienced. You know, whether it's the loss of a home or a job, the loss of a relationship. Maybe for some of us, when we were young, in our early 20s, we had our hearts broken, and now we think, is it possible to love again? We've lost relationship. We've lost maybe even meaning, significance in life. We walk around, we don't know why our life is worth living. Maybe we've lost a wife or a husband, a child, a father or a mother. We've lost friendship. We feel like we're alone. And we're in that cycle of discouragement and despair. Loss that leads to suffering, but then we get into that cycle of discouragement and despair. Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, writes to us today to say we can break that cycle. That loss leads to suffering, which is going to happen to every one of us, doesn't have to necessarily lead to discouragement and despair. That's the message that God has for us today. We can break that cycle, we can move forward. And as we consider that, and as we jump into what Paul is saying in more detail, let me just share one other thing that I think is going to help us. It's this beautiful idea that with our kids, we sometimes hold back. We sometimes don't share the whole story. In fact, sometimes we almost lie to our kids. You know, for instance, if you're going on a date and your kids are at home, you leave them at home with the macaroni and cheese. You don't tell them that you're going out to a nice restaurant or you're going to a movie or you're doing something fun. You don't give the whole picture. And I have to admit, sometimes I even do that with my wife. If I know I'm going out to a restaurant and I'm thinking, Lori would love to be here, I don't share all of that. But maybe we do that even more with our kids. There's something on the internet, maybe you've seen it, it's had about 15 million views. And it's this story of, it's this family who, and there's a bunch of these stories, but there's one that's had all kinds of views. They take their kids, and instead of taking them to school, they surprise the kids and they say, we're going to Disneyland. And you see their reaction. So, like, you know, instead of taking your kids to somewhere like school or, you know, the dentist or someplace they don't want to go to, sorry, dentist, but they surprise them. Watch this video, and where's my clicker? There it is. It's kind of actually the younger sibling who doesn't really get it. That's just kind of fun. But I wanted to show that to us because there's a reality that we need, that we see in Scripture that we need to be reminded of. Not to deny the hardships we're experiencing now, not to deny the realities of things like school or math tests. Sorry, math teachers out there, those are the worst. But there's a place that we're going to, and it's the happiest place, and it's not even on earth. I mean, it's the happiest place ever. And that's what Paul points to in these verses. And let's just jump right into it. Overcoming hurt, loss, discouragement. We accept the hope of a new future. And actually starts right in verse 18. We consider our present sufferings not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed. That creation is frustrated. Yes, there is hardship. There is a reality that there is suffering. So maybe that's the first thing we need to realize. Just because we're a follower of Jesus doesn't mean there's not hardship. Scripture doesn't just paint a rose-colored picture that says, hey, everything is great. No, no hardship. No, there is hardship. But look what Paul goes on to say. That creation, even creation, is going to be liberated, brought into freedom and glory. Freedom. Freedom from failure, freedom from brokenness, freedom from frustration. That right now we live in a place where people are broken. We are broken people. But we're going to a place where there's freedom. And notice the end of verse 21. Brought into freedom and glory. What is glory? We talk about God and his glory, but here it's talking about creation, including us, that is going to be brought into freedom and glory. What is glory? It's what God intended our lives to be. It's his glory through us. It's not what we've done, it's what Christ has done. And we accept this future, this hope. Again, not just wishing away the hardships we have now, but knowing there is so much more to come. And that gives us hope. And then he goes on, he talks about experiencing the hope of belonging. Verses 22 through 25. It says that we know that all of creation has been groaning. Verse 23, not only so, but we ourselves were the first fruits of the Spirit. We growed inwardly as we eagerly wait for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our body. If you have your Bible or your device, that word adoption is a key word. Highlight that word. Pastor Ted talked about that last week. Adoption is Paul's favorite metaphor to talk about what it means to be part of the family of God. And if you remember last week, and I watched this on YouTube because I wasn't here, but Pastor Ted talked about how Eric and Jess Anderson, they adopted Noe. After they were here, they moved and they had an adoption. And Ted did a great job talking about just the adventure of life and the adventure of following Jesus, our daring faith theme. Ted did a great job just kind of challenging us to take steps of faith, of adventure in our walk with God. Belonging is a key idea I want us to get out of adoption as well. That not only is it an adventure following God, but we're adopted into his family. We use family language as a church. And I know that for some, that can be a hardship because for some of us, family can be a negative. I've talked to people who say, yeah, I come from a dysfunctional family. We know how to put the fun in the word dysfunctional. You know, they kind of joke about it. But we have hardships in our family. But God brings us together. I think the greatest thing about being part of a family is that idea of belonging. It's not what we've done, it's what God has done. God wants to bring us together as his family. God wants to bring others who aren't here right now to be a part of his family. It's an inclusive term. It doesn't matter if you come here today and you're a single person or you're married or you have kids or you don't have kids. We're talking here about being a part of God's family. That our life as a follower of Jesus, it's more than just ourselves. It's being a part of God's family. It's being in a church family. It's being a part of God's broader family. There's a family of churches we have in Modesto. We're a part of God's family in Modesto with us and Sherwood Bible down the street and the small churches, the big churches. We're all part of God's family here in Modesto and around the world. That's what God wants us to be a part of, to belong. And that whole idea of adoption, and Ted did a great job talking about this last week. You know, blessings to all of us who have experienced that in one way or another. You experience or understand a piece of what it is to be a part of God's family in ways that others of us cannot. Those who have gone through adoption, those who have adopted children themselves, they know the hardship. They know the cost. They know what it's like to try to adopt and have a hard time adopting or have somebody changing their mind or the cost involved, the legalities involved with adoption. And as we think of what God has done for us through Jesus Christ, that he has paid the price. He has done everything that's needed to be for us to be a part of his family, and it isn't easy. It cost him his very son. But Jesus went to the cross so that we could be adopted into God's family. Because for God, there was no cost too high that he wasn't willing to pay for our adoption. And that's one of the beauties with families who have adopted, that they pay that cost. They make that sacrifice. And we see that here as we understand what God has done for us to become children, to know that you are a son of God, you are a daughter of God, that you are an heir, that you own everything that God owns, that it is all for you, that we can experience that acceptance, that grace, that we've been redeemed. And that's a hope worth waiting for. That we have, it says in verse 23, we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit, we groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption to sonship. We get a piece of that family experience here. There's a piece of that experience of what it's like to be in God's presence forever with his church. And as we think of God's church, the kingdom of God, maybe similar to an adoptive family as well. It's people with different backgrounds, different ethnicities, different cultures. We get a little taste of that here. In Modesto Covenant, we get a little taste of that. We get a taste of it as we look at all of the different churches in Modesto. I love getting together with other pastors in Modesto for lunch, for prayer. They bring all different Christian traditions, and we're richer for that. Think of the kingdom of God. When we're gathered together, that wedding feast of the Lamb, when people from every culture and tribe and tongue gather, it isn't just a melting pot where everyone's the same. It's all the differences that we come together, and it's a greater experience of who God is. That belonging, that we have a family here. And let me just, before I move on, because this is just such a great idea. If you're here today and you feel like you don't have that family, you don't have a church family, you feel just disconnected, even if you're here as a part of Modesto Covenant and you feel like, boy, I just don't feel like I quite am a part of it. Just know God wants you to be a part of his family. God wants you to feel connected. No family on this side of eternity is perfect. And that's true of Modesto Covenant as well. But you know what? We want to be as much as we can, as best we can. We want to be God's family here together. We want to welcome you into our family. We want this to be your family. We want you as much as we can to experience the warmth and the grace of God here. And I'll be the first one to say we're not perfect at it. But we'll do our best. And we're going to grow. And we'll have grace towards one another, as we remember that we're still on this side. We haven't experienced all of what God wants for us in glory. And then lastly, I want to end with just some practical things. Paul ends this section, and again, I'm stopping right before verse 28 today, because that's kind of a climax that then goes into the rest of the chapter. So you want to make sure to come back next week. You want to catch the end of this message series, because Romans, I heard it in one of our songs today. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. It just keeps getting better in Romans 8. So don't miss us next week. But But this passage ends through verse 27. It's about prayer, about talking to God, that we have direct access to God, that when we're going through hardship, talking to God and having his presence in prayer makes all the difference. And I think about this a little bit as I talk with my own kids. You know, this interesting thing happens, at least with our kids, to some degree. When they're young, like when they're elementary age kids, they talk about anything and everything. And then, like, adolescent hits, this kind of time where parents aren't cool anymore, or, you know, you kind of hold back, the kids hold back a little bit. And I can say this with my kids here because it's just a reality. You know, they're becoming individuals, they're becoming adults. But you kind of get to this point where all of a sudden the only thing you hear from is like, more food, you know, more food. You know, and you say, okay, let's sit down, let's talk. How was your day? Let's have this conversation. And it just doesn't happen. Like, they want to leave the room when you do that kind of thing. I mean, but sometimes what happens, and I see this even yesterday as we're doing stuff around the house, it isn't those times of sitting them down to have conversation. It's if you can get them to do things with you, sometimes conversation just happens. And I think it's that way with us and with God too. Prayer can be frustrating. We think it's formulaic. We think it's hard just to sit down with God. Okay, here's our time. It's his prayer time. But sometimes it's just throughout the course of our day. We're doing our task of the day, and we need the Lord's help. For me, as I'm in ministry doing things, I think, God, I need your help with this. And here's this thing. I just bring it to the Lord. It's kind of throughout the day. I'm working on a passage. I'm just moved to prayer. Or even I'm moved to praise. Just like with our kids, we need to be doing things with them, and then conversation happens. But there's also those times with our kids we do need to just sit down and say, okay, hey, let's talk. We got some stuff to talk about. And with God, there's times we just got to sit down and say, God, let's talk. There's stuff we've got to talk about. And as we're reading scripture, as we're praying, as we're just bearing our heart to God. There's even been a couple times in my life I've even written letters to my kids. Because I think I've got to say this well. They need to hear my heart in this. And whether I actually give them that letter or I just express it. And there's times we do that with the Lord as well. And maybe especially when we're going through hardships, that we talk to God. And so from these verses, I want to give just a few ideas of how prayer works. First, it's clarifying. Look at what it says in verse 26. We do not know what we ought to pray for. Prayer moves us from confusion to concrete action. Think of Jesus. Jesus pulled away, went to the mountainside early in the morning, he prayed, and then he went out and he said, I do what the Father tells me to do. I do what I see God already doing. His heart is in tune with God. So it clarifies our direction, our path, what God wants us to do. You know, I think even as we have with this facility, you know, and this morning, we're still figuring things out with the sound, and we're still nailing down some last details of the facility. So much of what we have done in our master plan has been just bathed in prayer. Not just as we moved into this facility, we had a prayer walk as we moved in, but way back when we were thinking, God, are you leading us to do something with our facility, began with prayer. It began with a discerning. God moves us into action. That's just one example. But I thought of that this morning. Prayer also, here's another C word, it's cathartic. He who searches our hearts. Prayer helps us express our deepest burdens to our most powerful ally. What does cathartic mean? It's about our emotions that we need to get out. Maybe you've heard somebody say, I had a good cry. I've heard that phrase. I've never experienced that myself, but I actually cry more in movies than my wife does. So, but where we have these emotions that we need to get out, we need to unload those. You know, for some of us, we in a sense we want to have a hernia for God. We're going to keep everything in, and you know, it's just. But we release that emotion, that heart towards God? Why is music and our worship, why is that so vital in our life together? You know, why is the book of Psalms just a wonderful book of poetry, of music? Why is that so important? It's our emotions. It's allowing us to express our hearts to God. Why is it that when we can come and we can worship the Lord and just release ourselves to Him in worship, the cares of the world somehow, the burdens, we can release those. They just kind of fall off our back. I'm not saying they're not there, but there's something about just releasing that emotion to God. Prayer does that. And then the last one, it's we're being connective. That it's in accordance with the will of God. That God moves us together. He moves us into intimacy with God and between God's people. In accordance with the will of God. That's personal, God's will for us, and it's also as a body of believers. Sometimes we read scripture. I just want to remind us of this. We come to verse 27. The Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. We think of it so personally. Okay, I want to follow God's will in my life. I want to do what God wants me to do. But we have to remember this is written to a church. So yes, God does lead us personally in our lives. But God's heart also is for His church, that we together follow Him, that we make a difference in the world together for Him. It connects us with God. This week, and I don't remember, maybe it might have been with Colleen when we were with Rick in the hospital. Rick had surgery this week. You know, just knowing that, and Colleen, I think you might have said this, or it might have been even our conversation with the nurse. We just saw God work. Rick was having surgery. There was a nurse that came in, and she said, "Oh yeah, I just had that same procedure done, you know, when I was younger." And that was just such a cool thing that the nurse could talk, then Colleen and Rick could talk with the nurse about what was going on. There were some questions with Rick's surgery. Was it going to be successful and to what degree and all these kind of things? But Colleen made the comment. She said, I don't know how people could do this without Jesus. And that kind of stuck with me as I think about it. For all of us, with whatever we face, Paul here is writing, answering the question, yes, I know there's no condemnation, but why do I feel like I'm being punished? There's times where we simply have to trust in the Lord, that we need Jesus. And here's a reality for us when we're really going through it. Here's this idea of connectedness. Sometimes our faith might even falter, but we rely on the faith of others. The others, we're going to come alongside to say, yeah, Jesus is with you. He will get you through. Prayer. Whatever hardship we face, to know that Jesus is there. And there's a greater glory to come. Let's pray together. God, we thank You.